All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. Joining me now is a man who we've had on the show many, many times. I'm a great admirer of his work, always have been. Award-winning mystery novelist, columnist for PJ Media, author of The Great Good Thing, A Secular Jew Comes to Faith in Christ. Andrew, welcome, sir.
Hey, Steve, it's great to be here.
A little more of a serious tone than we usually pursue in other interviews. And I want to get to the book. I want to get to your story. But I also want to touch on the news of the day. And, you know, that could be the police shootings. That could be the debates getting closer and closer. We also had some reports today that we're going to get to earlier in my noon show from Jim Hoft at the Gateway Pundit, who said someone, a well-placed conservative, told him that Hillary might be plotting to pull out of the debate. If that were to happen, would that shock you?
It wouldn't shock me. It would surprise me. I mean, I've heard this rumor before. I've heard it like for a couple of weeks. You know, it's just with the rumors about her health, I just think it would be a tremendous mistake. You know, she can pull any excuse she wants, but pulling out a debate always looks like cowardice. And in this case, it wouldn't just look like cowardice. It would also look like she didn't have the stamina to do it. She wasn't strong enough to do it. It would give Trump, you know, stuff to play off for weeks, basically. And all the mainstream media, which have been hammering Trump, no matter what he says, it's a gaffe, no matter what he says, it's stupid, they're just not going to get past that. If she pulls out, actions speak louder than words, and if she pulls out, it's cowardice, and it looks like she's sick.
Yeah.
And I that's why I think she won't do it,
right?
But she might. Maybe she is too sick. She can't.
That would be the only reason, because I agree with you. I think if she were still up by 15 points, I think she might try it, but to do it at this point, when everything she's done has failed and the lead has shrunk to the point where there's basically no lead, it's a political suicide.
I agree. Remember, Trump did it before Iowa, and it cost him that primary. I mean, it's just, you know, this is what people expect, and they have every right to expect that you will show up and argue face-to-face with the candidate. That's, you know, that's a basic kind of American principle, that you face the person that you're attacking all the time. I don't think she'll do it. I just don't think she can afford it unless she really is too sick to do it.
Yeah, no, that would be the reason. Absolutely. Then you have to weigh, you know, going and getting sick compared to just not showing up and say which is the lesser of the two evils. She yesterday issued a statement, Andrew, speaking on a radio show, Steve Harvey, I think, and she was talking about, you know, we played this earlier, talking about how the shooting in Tulsa, you know, already the cop is guilty. This has to stop. I could talk to white people and help them understand what's going on here. You know, here's a woman. We don't know what happened in Tulsa. Yeah, we have a video, but the cop may be, you know, get off because she may be justified in what she did. A jury or the evidence has to be gathered. I mean, but Hillary weighed in immediately. And here's a woman who the Philadelphia Police Department said she turned her back on us. We're supporting Trump. Yet in Philadelphia at the convention, she brought up Michael Brown's mother and other mothers as if Michael Brown's mother has some case against society or the police.
I know. This whole Black Lives Matter routine, this narrative that Obama basically created to distract people from his failures at home and abroad, it's a disgrace. And to hear Hillary Clinton say she's going to do outreach to white people, she said she's going to explain to us white people that this is not who we are. And I know, you know, you and I, Steve, we both wake up in the morning thinking, gee, I'm a white person, I think I'll go out and randomly shoot some black guy, you know? I
mean, no, gee, I'm a white person, I hope Hillary tells me what to do. That's what I like.
Yeah, exactly. That's right. And, you know, they keep using this phrase, systemic racism. Anytime a politician uses the phrase systemic racism, the answer should be name one law. Because that's what systemic means, is name one law in the system that is prejudice against black people or against anybody, because there are none. There used to be systemic racism in this country and in other countries, but there's not anymore. And so I don't know what she's talking about. If there's 300 million people in this country, a lot of police officers, hundreds of thousands of police officers, one of them's going to make a mistake from time to time, and one of them may be a bad hat from time to time. But if you listen to that Harvey interview, she says, well, there are good policemen out there, as if good policemen weren't the norm.
Right.
Good policing is the norm in this country.
Yeah, she's pandering. It's obvious she's pandering. All right, I want to move on. I want to talk. You know, faith is so important, and I think we're at such a crossroads in this country, and I just hope and pray that you know, no matter what one's faith, I just hope that family is able to pass it on to children, and I hope it remains as a as something that not only binds us together, but certainly is there for the individual to get the individual through tough times. And I hate to think and read some of the reports that, you know, God has less of a role in people's lives in this country than in a long, long time. I choose not to believe it, because I think when push comes to shove, people will turn to God, whoever and however they believe that God is, in times of need. So with that as a backdrop, I know lots of secular Jews. I can't describe myself as an ultra religious Jew of any sort. I go to the synagogue on the high holidays and try to do some other things along the way between them. But you were a secular Jew, and you changed. You found Christ. Was it not enough being secular anything? If you were a secular Christian, do you think you would have then become a more a more religious, devout Christian? Tell me about your circumstances.
Well, I think the thing is, not only was I raised, I was raised in the traditions of Judaism, but my parents didn't believe in God, so those traditions made absolutely no sense to me. And I talk about in the book how after I was bar mitzvahed, I received all this, jewelry and money and bonds as a gift, and I put it in a box, and I was, 13 years old, I was excited to have so much money. But when I realized that I had been a hypocrite about 6 months later, thinking about it, I realized I'd been an utter hypocrite to stand up at my bar mitzvah and announce that I believed in things that I didn't believe. I crept out one night after everyone had gone to bed, and I threw away all these thousands of dollars worth of gifts that I'd received for my bar mitzvah, and I thought, I'm done with religion.
Wait, now. You threw away cash? And
yeah,
checks?
I did. I know.
Oh, my goodness.
what a crazy man. I wanted to be done with religion, and not only did I live a secular life, but I lived in a secular world. I lived in New York. I went to London for a while. I worked in Hollywood. I mean, these are places where there is open hostility toward religion, and the basic narrative is, if you're an intellectual, if you're an intelligent person, if you're a sophisticated person, never mind intelligent, if you're a sophisticated person, you don't believe. Belief is for the hicks. Belief is for those people clinging to their religion and their guns. And that was basically the narrative that surrounded me, that engulfed me, and so I just naturally kind of went with that flow. And it took a long time, over many years, over many decades of thinking about the world, where I started to think, you know what, this doesn't make any sense. This doesn't make any sense. If there's no God, there can be no absolute morality, and that means that a Nazi who murders a child is just really as good as a priest who gives a beggar bread, and that doesn't make any sense to me. That's not a realistic proposition, and nobody believes it. Even the college kids who say they believe it don't believe it. And so once I realized that there had to be a God for the world to make any sense, I began to pray. And it was kind of an accident. I mean, I just kind of thought, as an experiment, I'll pray one day. I was reading a book where a character prayed, so I tried it. And it transformed my life. You know, it completely changed my life to be in a relationship with God. And it took about 5 years from that point when I started to realize that the God I believed in was Jesus Christ. And what happened really was, I realized that prayer had transformed my life, and I kind of went to God and I said, gee, you've done so much for me. What can I do for you? Because I'm just some, poor clown here, and you're kind of, the king of the universe. It's kind of an unfair deal. What can I do for you? And I really heard, it was almost a voice. It wasn't quite a voice, but it was this absolute knowledge that I should be baptized. And I remember thinking, you got to be kidding me. You have got to be kidding me. Because it really created problems. It created problems working in Hollywood. It created problems with friends I had, and it would have created terrible problems with my father, who would have just gone absolutely mad. But just as I was about to tell him, he fell into his fatal illness. And so my conversion, it's a dramatic story, it's in the book, but my conversion was really a kind of double experience of watching my father decline and also training for my baptism. And it was really a dramatic
thing. How did you reconcile that? I mean, Did you see that as any kind of, I don't even know if this is a proper question, any kind of sign, any kind of a coincidence? You know, Stephen McDonald, the great police officer who was shot at the subway station in Central Park now probably 30 years ago, says there's no coincidences, only God incidences.
That's basically what I believe. Once you start to see it, you can't unsee it. Before you see it, you think everything's a coincidence, just crazy stuff that's happening. But once you see it, you can't unsee it. And look, I don't think, you know, God arranges, like, oh, I'm going to kill this guy.
No, I don't mean that. I don't mean that. Yeah, yeah.
But there is a flow to life. That it was so dramatic, you know. I wanted to tell my father, even though I knew it was going to cause trouble, just
sure.
Just to be honest with him.
Sure.
But when I realized he was sick, I thought I'm just not going to ruin the last 6 months of his life.
Well,
and break his heart.
I don't want you to give away too much of the story. It's a fascinating story, and like I said, anybody who you know finds religion and uses as a guiding light. That's good by me. And the book is The Great Good Thing, A Secular Jew Comes to Faith in Christ, our friend Andrew Klavan. Thank you, sir.
Thanks a lot, Steve. It's great to see you.
You too. John Zogby is next. And Gimme Five. Don't go away.